I don't entirely know why, but I was inspired to decide this summer to work on a sermon and title it The Aging Process. Now, I thought that it might be somewhat humorous to have a nice little anecdote about growing older to start off the sermon, but as I look around the room, there's not that much funny about it, is there? It's just not that funny at a lot of times. On the other hand, it's a part of our life, and I think we need to, what am I going to teach you? But at the same time, we can review some things and obviously look at what God says about it and hopefully come away with a little better perspective on it, maybe a couple things in clearer focus. We don't need to turn here for these first couple of scriptures, but in Proverbs 16:31, you can take notes and then look them up later if you like. Proverbs 16:31, it says, "The silver-haired head is a crown of glory if it is found in the way of righteousness." And so that is our purpose, you know, as long as we're going to grow older and we have God's truth, we'd better be working on the path of righteousness and acquiring that. Leviticus 19:32 says, "You shall rise before the gray-headed and honor the presence of an old man and fear your God. I am the Lord." Of course, in this room, we never get to sit down, would we? Proverbs 17, verse 6 says, children's children are the crown of old men, and the glory of children is their father. That points, of course, to the generational aspect that God wants us to have on transmitting and connecting with the next generation, the truth of God, and the way that a child should go. Many, many scriptures we could go to. I could spend the entire time just working on these alone. Nevertheless, let's turn to Deuteronomy chapter 4. We'll begin there with scriptures we'll actually look at and spend some time with. Deuteronomy chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, it says, "Now, O Israel, listen to the statutes and the judgments which I teach you to observe, that you may live." So the purpose of these statutes and judgments is life. "And go in and possess the land which the Lord your God, the Lord God of your fathers, is giving you. You shall not add to the word which I command you, nor take from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you." Of course, this is given to ancient Israel, but it truly applies to us also. We're going to be taking possession of offices in God's kingdom and have rulership under Christ for 1,000 years and a whole lot of responsibility. And I think it's incumbent upon us that we are preparing for that now and take seriously our calling and our duty in obeying God now and in teaching millions and billions of people in the future. Continuing on in verse 3, "Your eyes have seen what the Lord did at Baal Peor, for the Lord your God has destroyed from among you all the men who followed Baal of Peor." Now, of course, we weren't there for that. We have it here to read about. But how many times in our lives has God taken an interventive approach for us and changed the course of our life for the good? Sometimes we get trials. Sometimes He just takes things out of our way. Things we don't realize or we can get out of, He's right there to take them away for us. And we spent time at the feast in the past talking about some of these things, groups of us, and it's amazing the things that God has done for us individually on a personal basis. Continuing on again in verse 4, "But you who held fast to the Lord your God are alive today, every one of you." And as long as we hold fast to the Lord our God, we're going to have life in us forevermore. Verse 5, "Surely I have taught you statutes and judgments, just as the Lord my God commanded me, that you should act according to them in the land which you go to possess. Therefore, be careful to observe them, for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the peoples who will hear all these statutes and say, 'Surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people.'" Well, this didn't happen for ancient Israel in the greater sense. The last few thousand years, they've been on the wrong end of trouble for not obeying God. But nonetheless, for all of us, what are people going to say about God's people when we're changed into God beings and we will have fulfilled these scriptures for our part and are living God's law perfectly? Verse 7, "For what great nation is there that has God so near to it as the Lord our God is to us, for whatever reason we may call upon Him? And what great nation is there that has such statutes and righteous judgments as are in all this law which I set before you this day?" And here we go, a little bit of a warning. "Only take heed to yourselves and diligently keep yourself, lest you forget the things your eyes have seen, and lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life, and teach them to your children, and your grandchildren, especially concerning the day you stood before the Lord your God in Horeb, when the Lord said to me, gather the people to me, and I will tell them and hear my words, that they may learn to fear me all the day they live on the earth, and that they may teach their children. And so here, by telling our children and our grandchildren, ancient Israel in this particular case, but us also, that information and understanding and the willingness to obey is often transmitted to the next generation, which is what we want, is it not? Who doesn't want their children to have as good a life or better life than they had? I certainly want mine to, and I know you do also, and have also. I have a few thoughts here on the aging process, and some things that happen to us as we grow older, nothing that you don't already know about, but just to mention them for the sake of putting them in perspective. And this is not just for old people, so if you're young, and that starts with anybody who's younger than me, and it's always been in my life, anybody who's old is older than me, that's just the way I thought about things, I guess. But if you're young and you consider that whatever that is to you, consider the life process that you've gone through thus far, however old you are, and think back a little bit. And for the kids, it's important to have a perspective that's a little bit out of just the here and now. And I know that because I deal with teenagers all day, every day, 5 days a week, and then I have my own. Teenagers are often very in the here and now. Getting a student at school to think past Saturday night is a real task, no matter what day of the week it is. But nonetheless, in youth, we think time moves very slowly. We ask questions like, will I ever get to be a teenager? When I finally get into my 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, whatever it is, I will have life by the tail, so to speak. I'll have it all figured out. I'll be doing well. I'll be on my path. It's the when I finally arrive syndrome. That's what I call it. Career set, family started and on track, finances set in order. Good luck with that in the age of man. It just doesn't always work out that way. And yet, that's what we hope for when we're young. As we grow older, the mind matures, hopefully, and we develop better thinking skills, and we make better, sometimes even wise, decisions. We take more time to consider a matter. We hope the outcome is guided by the consideration we give to influencing the results of events and situations we are presented with. And as we grow still older, the body starts to fail. We experience various trials, frailties, and shortcomings. We can see the end approaching. This should narrow our focus to eliminate those things in our lives which distract us, discourage us, and can often derail us. One thing is for sure. As we grow older, our perspective changes, and we often think that we have life figured out. I know more than others. Get out of my way. I've got this. Listen to me. I have better understanding than you do. We've all heard this attitude, at least from people in our lives, and hopefully we haven't exhibited it since we've been in the church, but sometimes we fall short on things. One other thing is for sure. All is vanity. The converted mind has a significant advantage. The Spirit of God keeps us focused on humility. We remain grounded and have at least the opportunity to separate ourselves from that which might keep us out of the kingdom of God. Although we should have advanced knowledge, understanding, and wisdom by the time we reach old age, whatever that is, we may not. And we may even be able to achieve the goal earlier in life than others. It's a maturity thing. And so that's kind of the underlying theme here today. We've talked about this many times in the past. We've heard this primary theme a couple, three times here at the feast this year. And yet, you know, how mature are we? And we're mature in the sense that we get older. And that doesn't mean we can't have fun, but how mature are we in the mind in terms of how God looks at things? Consider Deuteronomy chapter 8. Deuteronomy chapter 8. Beginning in verse 1, every commandment which I command you today, you must be careful to observe, that you may live and multiply, and go in and possess the land of which the Lord swore to your fathers. And you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way these 40 years in the wilderness. 40 years in the wilderness. Why? Three-step process here. To humble you and test you. Whether you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And so those three-step process applies to us also. Some of us have been around a little less than 40 years, some a little more. And yet we've been wandering through a land that's not our own. All this time that we've been baptized and called. And God is working the same three steps in us here and now. He humbles us. First thing, we've got to be humble. Second, He can test us. He can try us. He can prove us. And then the third thing is, He wants to know what is in our heart, whether you would keep His commandments or not. And the question is not, am I going to keep the commandments? The question should be for us at this stage is, how well am I going to keep the commandments? Because when we step outside of the law, we need to step back in. We need to make sure we're on track. And as quickly as we realize we're getting to the edge or stepping over, we need to immediately stop. Because the further we go, the easier it is to keep going, isn't it? And sometimes, sins easily ensnare us. We need to be on guard. Hebrews 11. Beginning in verse 13. We've been here already. This is breaking into the thought. It's a little bit of a summation of what's happened before. Beginning in verse 13 of Hebrews 11, "These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth." We too. "For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. And truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return." Do we want to go back to the country we were in before? I don't. I mean, most of us are in that country in terms of where we live. The best place, as far as I'm concerned, the best place on earth throughout the history of man for us so far. And yet it fails miserably. It's an utterly rejectable proposition that man has put forth here. And we can see the end of this nation approaching. Verse 16, "But now they desire better, that is, a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for He has prepared a city for them." Two things here. All this time, even before we were born, God has been preparing a city for us. Nice forethought and preparation on His part. It's an honor to have Him do that for us. And the other thing here is, we want to make sure that this is true for all of our lives. God is not ashamed to be called their God. And so if we think like that, and we consider that anything we might do might bring shame on God or make Him embarrassed, just like with our human parents, we ought to stay away from something like that, shouldn't we? There are at least seven functions or reasons for trials. And I think I've gone over this before. I don't know whether it was in a sermonette back home or at the feast, but I want to bring those up. Sometimes we tend to think that there's only one perspective on trials, but there's more. One reason for trials is for punishment. And I would offer, and I've here in my notes, the entire chapter of Deuteronomy 28. On the other hand, it's just the last half of the chapter is the punishment part. That's what we call the blessings and cursings chapter. We don't need to turn there. I think we know that pretty well, but as a nation, punishment comes. And as a people, punishment comes. Same with individual usage. Another reason is for correction. This is one people often go to. Punishment and correction are the two of the most popular, if you will, reasons why people think that trials come. I would offer Proverbs 23 here. See if we can turn that. I can turn that real fast. Probably not. Yeah, pretty fast. Proverbs 23, verses 13 and 14. "Do not withhold correction from a child, for if you beat him with a rod, he will not die." Scripture my kids wish wasn't in the Bible, but not so much. "You shall beat him with a rod and deliver his soul from hell." Of course, as children, we don't think along those lines so much, but we're thinking long term for our children's benefit and blessing, and ultimately their fellowship with us in the family of God when they're changed. Another scripture we could put here is Job chapter 5. Job 5, verse 17. "Behold, happy is the man whom God corrects. Therefore, do not despise the chastening of the Almighty." When we're getting corrected, by God, we don't always think it's, you know, certainly immediately we don't always think, oh boy, this is fun. And it's not fun, but it's something that we need to go through and something that we need to experience. And ultimately, when God corrects us, we are happy because we're returned to the path of life where happiness can occur. And we know that our walk is just a little bit better because of this. Another reason for trials is to draw us closer to God. And I would offer James 4 here. James 4, verse 8. Draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Another reason for trials is to develop in us a godly perspective. We need to start thinking more like God and look at things from His angle. Another one is, the fifth one is, as a true and fair witness for God. John chapter 9. I think we all ought to turn here because this one's an important one. This one comes up sometimes in discussing this with people, concepts. John chapter 9, beginning in verse 1. Now as Jesus passed by, He saw a man who was blind from birth. And His disciples asked Him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. So sometimes trials and tests come not because of something we've done or something somebody next to us has done. Why? But that the works of God should be revealed in him. It's just that simple and just that clear. Sometimes we get trials for the benefit of others. All of you have had a benefit from my trial, and I from yours, and each from each other. It all works together. Iron sharpens iron, as the saying goes. Number 6, to develop in us a godly compassion for others. Job 19, that's the wrong one. Job 19, beginning in verse 23, Job's lamenting his situation here. Oh, that my words were written. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book, that they were engraved on a rock with an iron pen and lead forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at last on the earth. And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God. Now he wants other people to know of his existence and his trial, so that they can benefit from it, hopefully without having to go through it. It's a little perspective on Job. I don't know that we always often think about is that, you know, he is, in spite of his shortcoming and his troubles and the situation he goes through, which is over quite a period of time apparently, he is thinking of others, people he doesn't even know. And that's what we're doing. We're preparing to teach people we don't know yet. You know, billions of people that we haven't even met. People who have lived and lived under agony and pain and suffering. People who are going to be living during the millennium and the 100-year period. People who are going to need to know God. And it's going to be up to us, at least in part, to teach them and to represent God's way properly. And the seventh way that I have here is so that God can have mercy on us through repentance. 1 Corinthians 10. Beginning in verse 11. Now all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Therefore let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. You know, it's an important warning for us. You know, here at the end of this age, we have a better understanding of Scripture than anybody in times past, for the most part. We're seeing prophecy happen and begin to develop here at the end. And we have the opportunity to witness this cataclysmic mess at the end of the age, if we live long enough. And we've seen things happen during our lifetime. Things that our ancestors and brethren who are asleep could only think about and talk about. It's amazing, I think, when we consider that. We have such an advantage. And yet we have a responsibility also. And the temptation is to think we're pretty hot stuff. But I'd like to remind us all, as we've been doing for years at the feast and through sermons, we live in the era of Laodicea. We don't live in Philadelphia anymore. We aspire to be Philadelphians and put on the benefits and blessings that they have and their attributes. But truly, the fact is we live in Laodicea. We need to come to a full grip of that so that we have a better understanding. Verse 13, no temptation has overtaken you except as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. But with the temptation will also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. There's always a way out. We don't see it very often. Sometimes in the midst of the trial, we don't see how to get out of it. And sometimes it's not ours to get out of. It's God's to take us out of, or to remove what's oppressing us or bothering us. It's up to Him sometimes to just take charge. And sometimes that's part of the lesson, waiting for God. You know, waiting for Him to take care of things on His terms, in His way. I'd like to consider some of the people in the Bible who have had trials, and a little bit about where they are in their lives as they go through these trials. I'd like to start with Joseph for a couple of reasons. One, he's early on in the Bible. Chronologically, he's a long time ago. But he was able to learn from a very young age. He was only 17 when his great trial began, and yet he was already ready. Now, he learned from a young age how to be faithful. Let's look at a couple of verses on him. Genesis 37. Well, the verses aren't on him. They're about him. Excuse me. Genesis 37, beginning in verse 18. Now when they saw him afar off, even before he came near them, they conspired against him to kill him. He had told his brothers his vision and how they were going to bow down to him, and they didn't appreciate that, carnal brothers that they were. They thought, well, we're older than you. Who are you? Well, they'll find out. Continuing on in verse 19, then they said to one another, look, this dreamer is coming. And I can hear the sarcasm dripping through that. This dreamer. Then they said to one another, look, this dreamer is coming. Come, therefore, now let us kill him and cast him into some pit, and we shall say some wild beast has devoured him. We shall see what becomes of his dreams. They thought they understood. Of course, they didn't. Jumping ahead a little bit here to chapter 39, verse 1. Joseph had been taken down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him down there. Of course, Ishmael's are his cousins. How about that, being sold into slavery and taken into another country by your cousins? And yet we don't hear him complaining about it. It's not recorded. Verse 2, the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master the Egyptian. No complaint there. And then he goes through all the things he's got to go through. He gets attacked by his master's wife, and he gets thrown in jail, and he has dreams there. He interprets the dreams of others. Skipping ahead to chapter 45. Chapter 45 of Genesis, beginning in verse 1. Then Joseph could not restrain himself before all those who stood by him. His friends, his brothers had come down to Egypt because they were out of food. And he cried out, make everyone go out from me. So no one stood with him while Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept aloud, and the Egyptians in the house of Pharaoh heard it. Then Joseph said to his brother, I am Joseph. Who does my father still live? But his brothers could not answer him, for they were dismayed in his presence. You know, they're afraid. It's been about 17 years since he's been sold into slavery. They think he's gone and out of their lives. And there he is, second most powerful person in Egypt, in charge of the food. And they're all standing before him. They're afraid, as they ought to have been. Then verse 4. And Joseph said to his brothers, please come near to me. So they came near. Then he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. But now, do not therefore be grieved or angry with yourselves, because you sold me here. For God sent me here before you to preserve your lives. And so he understood at some point during the process that he was supposed to be going through this. and that it was okay. And he accepted his fate. As much as it might have been what he, not what he thought he would be doing with his life, he was really willing and able to accept his lot in life. Now, in contrast to that, let's consider Job, our old friend. He's not a very young man at the start of his story. Yet he learned, and it was a very painful process for him. Some notes about Job's friends, because we often consider them. Let's consider what their experience is and their perspective in his trial. Job's friends do not understand his sin or his situation. Job's friends cannot help Job at his time of need. They sit there with him, but they can't really help him. They don't know how to apply their knowledge properly. They've got knowledge. It's evident they understand a lot of things, but they don't know what to do with it. They've got knowledge, but they don't know how to wield the wisdom that comes from that. They should have learned their lessons well enough to sort out the problem long before they are presented with Job's situation, if they're going to live righteously. But they weren't prepared for the trial when it hit. And it wasn't their trial directly, it was Job's. But isn't it also their trial because they're involved in it? Absolutely. They have a part to play. They fall short of their purpose in life. We're here to console each other and to help each other get into the kingdom of God. And they fail to comprehend their own shortcomings in his trial. It was not just Job's trial. It was a teaching moment for everyone involved. For Job, his wife, their children, their servants, the three friends, Elihu, and us. Everyone has something to learn from this. And not just Job's first group of children. He has another group of children, and it's a lesson for them too. Let's look at Job for a couple of minutes. Job chapter 1. Well, we know the story well, but I want to reinforce it a little bit and remind us of some of the basic scriptures that goes with it. Job 1, beginning in verse 1, there was a man in the land of Uz, whose name was Job, and that man was blameless and upright, and one who feared God and shunned evil. Well, that's a pretty good start. Blameless means usually morally pious, and upright means just. And seven sons and seven and three daughters were born to him. So he had 10 children. I'm already feeling sorry for his wife, but it's a lot of diapers or whatever. It's a lot of everything, isn't it? Nonetheless, verse 3, also his possessions were 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, very large household. 500 female donkeys and a very large household, so that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. And so he's a rich man. He's got a lot. And yet, verse 1 says what it says about him. He's able to manage that and pretty well stay in sight of God. So it was, verse 4. And his sons would go to and feast in their houses, each of his on his appointed day, and would send and invite their three sisters to eat and drink with them. Now we've speculated in the past that might be birthdays, you know, whatever it is. We have verse 5. So it was when the days of feasting had run their course that Job would send and sanctify them, means pronounce them ceremonially clean, and he would rise early in the morning and offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed. And they may have cursed God in their hearts. Thus Job did regularly. So this is an ongoing situation with this man and his family. Now, apparently, if they're sending for their daughters and meeting in their own homes, they're adults. So Job's not, he's no spring chicken. He's an adult, older man probably. And he has all these children that are living on their own. And that word cursed is interesting. It means treason. It means he thinks they may have committed treason against their sovereign by doing what they've done. He's not sure, but he thinks they might. Skipping ahead a little bit in chapter 2, beginning in verse 9. So he has some problems. His wife is sitting there or standing there watching him. She says, then his wife said to him, do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die. Well, ouch. That's not the best comment she could come up with, but that's what she did. I think it's very hard for people to watch somebody else suffer like Job was doing. I think if you know your mate is in that situation, it's kind of hard to just sit by. You want to do something, but what can you do? Well, we can do some things. We can pray, of course, and call for an anointed cloth and pray some more and try and console our mate or our friend. But there's just not a whole lot we can personally do. And so just standing by is kind of rough sometimes. Continuing on in verse 11, now when Job's three friends heard of all this adversity that had come upon him, each one came from his own place, Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite. For they had made an appointment together to come and mourn with him and to comfort him. And so his three friends from wherever they are, if they're in three different places, I don't know how they communicated, but they did. And if they lived in a similar area, they got a hold of each other somehow and said, have you heard about Job? Yeah, well, we ought to go talk to him and comfort him. And continuing in verse 12, and when they raised their eyes from afar and did not recognize him, they lifted their voices and wept. And each one tore his robe and sprinkled dust on his head toward heaven. Well, these are things that we would often see happen with people in the Bible. Verse 13, so they sat down with him on the ground 7 days and seven nights. That's a long time to visit your friend while he's in a trial. And no one spoke a word to him, for they saw that his grief was very great. Now, some of us are big talkers, and some of us are not. But to sit there for 7 days and seven nights with your friend and just help him grieve and suffer by just being patiently by his side, I think that takes something. It takes a skill and a patience. Skipping way ahead to chapter 32. And in the meantime, we hear from the friends and Job back and forth, and they all wrestle with the problem and don't do so well with it. Job 32, verse 1. So these three men ceased answering Job because he was righteous in his own eyes. Then the wrath of Elihu, the son of Barachel, the Buzite, of the family of Ram, was aroused against Job. For his wrath was aroused because he justified himself rather than God. Also against his three friends, his wrath was aroused because they had found no answer and yet had condemned Job. Now, because they were years older than he, Elihu had waited to speak to Job. He's gotten much of this in the right order. He's doing the right things here. He's waiting for the older men to take the lead. They're not able to deal with the situation. Verse 5, when Elihu saw that there was no answer in the mouth of these three men, his wrath was aroused. It's interesting. That word wrath has been used four times in the last four or five verses. I guess we're not supposed to miss that. Wrath is number 639. It means rapid breathing in the nostrils, passion or ire plus the countenance. God doesn't get after Elihu. He doesn't condemn him here. When he responds, he completely ignores Elihu's presence in terms of what the recorded message is. But he also doesn't praise him. And I don't know how far this goes with this breathing in the nostrils and the snorting that he's doing in terms of his anger with Job and the friends. So I'm open to it going either way. Either could have had a problem, or he was holding back from doing something or saying something that he was thinking to do, but he didn't follow through on. But Elihu gets a pretty good report here in terms of what he says. Continuing on, so Elihu, the son of Barachel the Buzite, answered and said, I am young in years, and you are very old. So apparently he was very old. Therefore I was afraid, and dared not declare my opinion to you. I said, age should speak, and multitude of years should teach wisdom. This is true. And so the question we have to ask ourselves is, at our stage of life, especially if we're older, do we have wisdom, and are we able to communicate and teach and help correct when it's the time to, and to do it in the proper way. Continuing on to verse 8, but there is a spirit in man, and the breath of the Almighty gives him understanding. Great men are not always wise, nor do the aged always understand justice. So just because we get older, we don't automatically, by osmosis, pick up wisdom. We have to work at it. Of course, we know this. And we have to do this on a regular, consistent basis. There are some things to consider here in Job's trial, and both in consideration of his trial and preparing for evaluating, enduring, and conquering our own trials and helping others with their trials. So again, I have seven little things here that we can ask ourselves, seven questions. Hope I don't go too fast for you, but in any event, the first question we should ask is, how well do I deal with trials? How well do I deal with trials? In other words, how am I doing with my part in Job's trial or in the trial of another member of the body of Christ? What should I have learned from Job's experiences or from the experiences of my brother? What can I learn here? Question number two, what role do or should I play during a brother's trial? What should I be doing when my brother has a trial? Questions we can ask under that would be, which of the players in the story of Job do I most closely identify with? Honestly. Obviously, in the area of Laodicea, we all think we're Elihu. But seriously, folks, with which individual do I most closely identify with? And if you reread the story and think about it carefully, we can see ourselves, and I think, in a couple of different situations here. And of course, that's a refined way of thinking and evaluating our situation. Question number three, have I properly prepared and equipped myself to competently comfort a friend or a brother during a trial? In other words, can I help my brother during a trial? Am I ready to? And we've seen from examples, and we'll see others, that some are and some are not. Question number five, do I understand the specific nature and purpose of trials in myself and in others? Do I understand the specific nature and purpose of trials in myself and in others? It's easy to grieve for oneself during a trial. Woe is me. But do I appreciate the overall experience? Supposed to count on all joy, of course. We don't do that immediately, but eventually we do. Well, at least I hope we do. Question number six. When I experience a trial, can I sort it all out? Sometimes we find ourselves in the middle of a maelstrom of troubles. And what do? Well, obviously the first thing to do is get on your knees, pray. But then what do? Time to act, time to wait. Time to get counsel. Whom do I counsel with? I mean, there's all kinds of questions that are derivatives of this that we need to be able to sort out. So question number six is, when I experience a trial, can I sort it all out? And number seven, do I actually learn from my trials and from the trials of others? And do I learn to overcome and avoid future problems? So how well do I use my trials to overcome and prepare for the next one? Because I have a clue for you here. There's going to be more trials. If we're done with the one we've just had and we're having a little bit of a break in trials, congratulations, God's giving you a break. But there's more coming. We're not done yet. So a summative or an umbrella question I would pose at this juncture in evaluating with how we deal with trials would be this. So this is a kind of a all-encompassing question for all seven of these. As I grow older, am I improving or am I failing to improve in how I deal with trials? And so now sometimes we need to take a step back from an individual trial or a set of experiences and look at the overall trend and tendency in our lives. Am I improving or am I not improving in how I deal with trials, in all aspects of it? Let's consider some more of the notable men of the Bible and their circumstances. Cain, we heard about him the other day. Cain utterly failed all three criteria. He didn't learn from his lessons over time, either one, in preparation for a trial, two, during his trial, or three, in retrospect. He stubbornly tried to have it his way, and it didn't work out so well for him, did it? His conclusion of the matter was that he couldn't bear his grief and sorrow. Well, I hope that's none of us. Of course, he's carnal, and he'll get his chance. But anyone can fall to that situation. David, another man, was a man after God's own heart, but he strayed, and it cost him. He lost his child, he tore apart another marriage, and he had a man murdered. He even involved another man in setting up the murder. He was a bloody man, not qualified to build the temple of God. His sins remain visible for all humanity to see and learn from. And so the key, of course, is to learn from someone else's mistakes and not repeat them or fall victim to them. Solomon, his vast experience in life serves us all in that we do not need to make the same mistakes he made. We can have his wisdom without paying his price. if we're careful. The prodigal son, interesting person here. Let's turn to that, Luke 15. Luke chapter 15. Beginning in verse 11. Then he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed on to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigious living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent himself into his fields to feed swine. So it seems to me that if he's joining himself to a citizen of that country, he's kind of selling himself into slavery, economic slavery, as the Bible prescribes, perhaps. Nevertheless, look at the choices he's made. He sold himself to a foreigner. Verse 16, and he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have a bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Now his older son was in the field. And as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, lo, these many years I have been serving you, and I never transgressed your commandment at any time. And yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours came, interesting phrasing there, isn't it? As soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed the fatted calf for him. And he said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that she would make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. Let's consider the perspectives of each of these persons in the time of life that they are. One younger son, one older son, and then, of course, the dad, who's quite a bit older. Where do you think each of these people is on the timeline of the aging or maturity process? Let's consider them. The prodigal son, some notes about him. He's carnally minded. Initially, he has a heart of stone. He comes to his senses, and he actually becomes humble in the process. That series of events and his experiences broke his will in terms of going off and doing whatever he wanted to do on his own. He just wanted to go live at his father's house where he knew he would be well treated and just eat whatever he was given and be a hireling. That he was happy with that. At least that's what it says. But he also returns to his father in a more humble state of mind. So I think he's a little bit teachable at this point, don't you? Humility makes us teachable. The other son, or the older son, he's also carnally minded. He also has a heart of stone. He resents his brother both initially and after his return. He's only interested in his personal loss, not his or his brother's or his father's potential gain. He's not thinking, oh great, my brother's back. Our family is more united and we're better off. We have more workers. We have more unity. He's thinking, he's going to take some more of my stuff. What about the dad? I think he's incredibly patient with both of his sons. He understands that his returning son may now be taught in a significant, even relevant way. He has both sons' long-term well-being in mind. He knows that the things of this life are largely irrelevant in the big picture. To get his son back was more valuable than any animal he had or anything he had as a possession. He also knows that God can restore or increase his holdings to match or exceed his former wealth. In short, he understands and appreciates the lessons from Job. Whether he knows that book of the Bible or not, he understands those lessons. He continually educates both of his sons, even after the one returns and the other one's complaining. He's still educating these boys. And he keeps the big picture and overall goals of life in perspective while he's doing all this. So we've mentioned something in these last three people that we need to talk about a little bit, I think. And we've heard about it in the feast already. The heart of stone. Let's look at the heart of stone for a moment and see some aspects of it. A heart of stone does not function properly like a heart of flesh. It has no feelings or sensation. It does not bleed or suffer when wounded. It's cold. It cannot change, and it is not malleable. It has no life in it and cannot bring life. And in the end, a heart of stone only brings death. Let's turn to Ezekiel chapter 36. Ezekiel 36. And we'll start in verse 22. We won't read all the way through it, but we'll read part of it here. Beginning in verse 22 of Ezekiel 36, it says, "Therefore say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, I do not do this for your sake, O house of Israel, but for my holy name's sake, which you have profaned among the nations wherever you went. And I will sanctify my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, which you have profaned in their midst. And the nations shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when I am hallowed in you before their eyes." So he makes clear twice, in fact, that he's not doing it because of anything Israel did good. He's doing it for his own sake. Verse 24, ultimately for Israel's sake, and ultimately for all the nations' sake, of course, because he's got the big picture in mind. Verse 24, "For I will take you from among the nations, gather you out of all the countries, and bring you into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. And I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. And I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh." Now, a lot of people have trouble with this because, well, I've got a heart of flesh. Like, I've got flesh for... No, it's the entire attitude and the underpinnings of the way these people are living. So the heart of stone. God did that for us, did he not? He took that heart of flesh that was carrying the burdens of this life. If you think back, and I know for a lot of us it's a lot of years, a lot of you have been around a lot longer than I have, but if you think back to before you were called and the life that you led and the sins that you committed, and I don't want you to dwell on them too much, but think about what God forgave you for and where you are now, it's humbling. And it's joyful. Verse 27, "I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them." And that's what we're doing. We're keeping the statutes, the judgments, and we're obeying God. And we can do that because we have a heart of flesh, one that feels, one that experiences, one that breathes life into us. And we got it from God. Philippians chapter 1. Let's try Philippians chapter 1. Verse 6. "Be confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Just as it is right for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my chains and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you are all partakers with me of grace." So he's speaking to us even here in this time and place. "For God is my witness, how greatly I long for you all with the affection of Jesus Christ. And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and all discernment." Do we think Paul has learned from his own trials and from the trials of others? Absolutely. Chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. "Therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship in the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind." And that's hard to do sometimes, isn't it? We try to be of one mind, and sometimes we don't quite get there. And yet we keep trying, because that's our commission. We're supposed to be of one mind, and we're striving to accomplish that. And we need to keep working at it. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, verse 3. But in lowliness of mind, more humility, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others. And that's what we've been doing. Let this mind, verse 5, be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that the name of Jesus Christ, and at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee should bow, and of those in heaven, and of those on the earth, and of those under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Absolutely. How do we fulfill these scriptures if we fall short of verses 14 and 15 in the same chapter? So Philippians 2, reading verses 14 and 15. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless, children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, amongst whom you shine as lights in the world. We need to fulfill this, both these verses. But how do we do this if we fall short? We can't fall short of the first 12 verses. And the answer to that is in verse 13. At the end of verse 12. Where it says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And if we're working out our own salvation with fear and trembling, that doesn't mean just not necessarily off on our own, doing our own thing. Certainly not that. But if we're concentrating on working out our salvation, not from a selfish perspective, but from an honoring God perspective, we're going to be doing the right things. And we're going to be doing what it says in the first 12 verses in this chapter. And we're also going to fulfill verses 14 and 15. Philippians chapter 3, beginning in verse 13. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. I press toward the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, let us, as many are as mature, have this mind, and if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal even this to you. Be mature. Submit to the aging process. Embrace it, and welcome it in your spiritual development. Do not become stagnant in growing in Christ. Colossians chapter 2. Beginning in verse 1. This is written for ancient times, but apparently also for the current day. For I want you to know what a great conflict I have for you and those in Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love, and attaining to all the riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the knowledge of the mystery of God, both of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. More about knowledge and wisdom. Now this I say, lest anyone should deceive you with persuasive words. For though I am absent in the flesh, yet I am with you in the spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Beware, lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. And from time to time, these things happen. We have problems, we try to figure things out, and sometimes people get confused. And sometimes from the outside, they're being used to deceive us. There needs to be heresy so that those who are made or faithful can be made manifest. That's what happens. And so after all these years, after our original organization, We've seen our way through all those trials and distractions and the opportunities to rip us out of the body of Christ. And here we are. And yet we're not done. There's still a ways to go. So make sure you guard your soul and yourselves carefully, because you don't want to be deceived at the very end. At least I don't. And I know you don't also. Jumping ahead a little bit to verses 16 and 17. So let no one judge you in food or in drink, or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbath, which are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. If we're doing these things correctly, we'll stand out as being very different from this world. People will not think to judge us if we are behaving like they are, but if what we do is different. So if we're different than the world, and we should be, and we are, both in our customs and habits and in the way we carry ourselves and deliver and we deliver ourselves to other people in terms of how we represent things. We don't do it like they do. We're going to stand out. And I know in my life, although I've not been as good an example as I could have been, people watch me. People I work with have watched me. And I've caught them a few times when I come back into the room talking about me. And it's mostly, well, why doesn't he do this? Or why does he do that? Or why did he leave? You know, he's been gone for a while. He won't eat the free lunch. Well, it's not free. It has a price attached to it. Not willing to pay that price for that free lunch. Verses 18 and 19. Let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility and worship of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, and not holding fast, to the head, from whom all the body, nourished and knit together by joints and ligaments, grows with increase that is from God. We need to stay attached closely to the head, to Jesus Christ. Let that mind be in us which is in Christ Jesus, it says. And we need to make sure that we're staying close to him. Skipping ahead here a little bit, we'll go to Deuteronomy chapter 32. Deuteronomy chapter 32. Beginning at verse 36, for the Lord will judge his people and have compassion on his servants when he sees that their power is gone. Now, Philadelphia had a little power, and so the next group apparently has no power. When he sees that their power is gone and there is no one remaining, bond or free, he will say, where are their gods, the rock in which they sought refuge? Who ate the fat of their sacrifices and drank the wine of their drink offering? Let them rise and help you and be your refuge. Now see that I, even I, am he, and there is no God besides me. I kill and make alive, I wound and I heal, nor is there any who can deliver from my hand. Now, of course, he's talking about Israel after the flesh. And these verses explain, at least in part, why he sends his people into captivity. Continuing on ahead with verse 40, for I raise my hand to heaven and say, as I live forever, and if I whet my glittering sword and my hand takes hold on judgment, I will render vengeance to my enemies and repay those who hate me. I will make my arrows drunk with blood and my sword shall devour flesh with the blood of the slain and the captives from the heads of the leaders of the enemy. Rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. Interesting. Gentiles rejoice with his people. For he will avenge the blood of his servants and render vengeance to his adversaries. He will provide atonement for his land and his people. That not only applies to the physical Israel, it does apply to us also, for his servants. So Moses came with Joshua, verse 44, the son of Nun, and spoke all the words of this song in the hearing of the people. Moses finished speaking all the words to all of Israel, and he said to them, set your hearts on all the words which I testify among you today, which you shall command your children to be careful to observe, all the words of this law. For it is not a futile thing for you, because it is your life. And by this you shall prolong your days in the land which you cross over the Jordan to possess. Servants. If he will have compassion on his servants, then why shouldn't we seek to be the best servants we can? Not just ancient Israel, but we also cross the Jordan if we get to go to the place of safety. And of course, spiritually, we cross into the holy land of the kingdom of God when we're translated into his existence, when we're no longer physical, but we're spirit beings. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Verses 24 through 26. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient. A lot of attributes we need to have there. In humility, correcting those who are in opposition. If God permits, perhaps will grant them repentance so that they may know the truth, and that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive by him to do his will. Now, of course, that's a challenge for us. And sometimes in this age, in this time in our lives, it doesn't always work out so that people repent. And yet we still try. The Scripture hasn't gone away. We still need to make sure that we are doing the right things. We still need to make sure that we're obeying God correctly. And we still need to make sure that we're being good servants. Chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Here we have an overview, an umbrella scripture or something that encompasses a large area of topic here. This is our commission in life. We're supposed to be inspecting this book on a regular basis, gleaning everything we can from it that's relevant to our salvation, and employing that in our lives as we can. Titus chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. But as for you, speak the things which are proper for sound doctrine. And this covers all of us here, brethren. That the older men may be sober, reverent, temperate, sound in faith, in love, in patience. The older women likewise, that they be reverent in behavior, not slanderers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. That they admonish the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, homemakers, good, obedient to their own husbands, and that the word of God may not be blasphemed. Likewise, exhort the young men to be sober-minded, in all things showing yourself to be a pattern of good works, in doctrine showing integrity, reverence, incorruptibility, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that one who is an opponent may be ashamed, having nothing evil to say of you. And sometimes that's a challenge. Sometimes when we find ourselves in a situation, we get upset. Or we may say something or do something that's just a little outside the lines. And we need to fix that because we want to make sure we're representing God properly at all times. Exhort bondservants to be obedient to their own masters, to be well-pleasing in all things, not answering back, not pilfering, but showing all good fidelity that they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior in all things. Adorn. Number 2885, to put in proper order. For example, to decorate, literally or figuratively. And it says here to snuff out a wick. And so I looked up the word snuff because that didn't quite, it makes sense, but it doesn't quite make sense in the dictionary. And snuff, two interesting definitions here. The first one, we often think of definition A here, to extinguish by or as if by the use of a candle snuffer, often used with out, so snuff something out. But think of this definition as much more apropos to our verse. Definition B, to crop the snuff of a candle by pinching or by the use of snuffers so as to brighten the light. I think that's a little more fitting in what we're supposed to be doing. How do we brighten the light by our demonstration of God's word in action in our lives? That's a question I would ask. You know, as we grow older, we should be better and more proficient at this. We should have more tools to use when we deal with people in our own personal situation of overcoming. We should have a better understanding and better wisdom to employ when it comes to working out our own salvation with fear and trembling. You know, how do we brighten the light? Well, brighten light stands out. It's unavoidable. Others are compelled to see it. And so the question I ask at this juncture is that how we adorn God's word? Of course, the perfect example is Christ that we should look to in terms of being mature throughout his life. And at different ages, he says exactly the right things. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has perfect character. And once it's developed in us, it remains forever in place unchanged. Christ has perfect character that will never change. And we want to be like Him. Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. Verses 1 through 4. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. Again, with the big picture. We want everybody to be saved, as many as are willing. For I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. So not only do they not have the wisdom they need to employ, they're even lacking the knowledge. And we know this from looking at the world around us. The Israelite nation we live in, they don't employ God's word. Some people try, some people say they do, but they truly don't. Verse 3, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness, well, that's a big mistake, have not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end, and we know that means the goal of the law, for righteousness to everyone who believes. He's our role model, our goal. He is the end of this journey we are on, the fulfillment of the aging process, whether we arrive at our destination as young people like Joseph or as older adults like so many others. Finally, brethren, and this is not the final scripture, but several of these begin with the word finally. So, Ephesians chapter 6. So I don't want you to think anything other than what's literally here. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 13. We won't read all of this explanation. We know this, most of us, probably by heart, or certainly close to it. But as a way of reminder as to how we should prepare to go out and continue in our walk with God. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. That's no small verse itself, by the way. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. 1 Peter chapter 3. Excuse me. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. Finally, see, I told you, all of you be of one mind. Be of one mind, we're told again. Having compassion for one another, love as brothers, be tenderhearted, be courteous, not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you were called to this, that you may inherit a blessing. Skipping ahead to verses 15 through 17. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you for a reason of the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear. Brethren, that's the first part of the step here. We need to prepare for the trial and prepare for the opportunity. Having a good conscience, verse 16. That when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. For it is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. You know, if we do something in error, we're taking our own stripes. We deserve them. But if we do something that represents God properly and we still pay for it, that's wages. And that's to our benefit and to God's glory, ultimately. We're not doing this for self. We're doing this to honor God who called us and gave us a life that has purpose and merit, worth, goals that are worthy, and a job in the future that's, the only word I can think of is awesome. And I know that in this world people overuse that word, but it's absolutely incredible when you think about it. How many billion people have lived up to this point in this world? 40, 50, 60 billion, some number like that. And out of all that, he calls out 144,000. Now to us, 144,000 seems like a lot, but not over 6,000 years, and not over all the billions, and not over the billions that are coming after us. What an honor it is. Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. Verse 8. Here we go again. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, I didn't do this to be humorous. It just so happened that a lot of these scriptures kind of make the point. Whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. And for a time, you know, when we're in the midst of a trial or during certain stages of our life, we think about the sad things or the troubled things or the problems. Okay. But the general trend and tendency of our life should be to meditate on the upward calling we have and on the noble things, the truth. Starting in the second half of verse 11, so 11b, I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere in all things I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. If we, over the course of our lives, in this aging process, we have become mature, we have this. We understand this, and we can do this. We can be successful in abounding and being abased. And we can do all things because Christ Himself strengthens us. Between now and the end of the feast, and also between now and the coming Passover season, and between now and our last breath, brethren, let's evaluate our trials as a measure of our progress. Let's look at ourselves and look at the experiences we have and make sure that we are on track, being obedient to God and representing things properly, forever learning and improving in our walk with God. And in conclusion, finally, 2 Corinthians chapter 13. 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Verse 5. So between now and the end of the feast, between now and Passover, and for the rest of our lives, examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves, or prove ourselves. Let's prove whether we're doing the right things or no. Do you not know that yourselves, that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you are disqualified? Yes, we do know this. But we need to be reminded of it from time to time, I think. We need to be cognizant of it and have it in the forethought of our minds. And throughout all the trials that we go through, verse 11, finally, brethren, farewell. Become complete. Interesting phrase. Become complete. Be of good comfort. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you.